Today's topic is creating a patient-centric experience to increase transparency in collections. We're going to get started in just a moment here as we come up on 2 p.m. Eastern. So I'll give everybody just another minute or so to dial in and get settled, and then we will go ahead and get started. All right, well, let's go ahead and get started with today's session. Again, thank you for joining us today. I'll give you a brief introduction of today's session and just a couple of housekeeping items, and then I'll go ahead and introduce our featured speakers today. So today we really want to talk about some price transparency strategies that hospitals can start embracing that really create that patient-centric experience. We know there's a lot of forces at play going on at the federal and state level related to policy and regulation, and we're not really going to get too much into that today. We really want to focus on how can you create a better experience for your patients so that they're more comfortable with paying for their care so they can worry about getting better, and also the hospital can focus on that as well. So I'm going to get started and just talk about some new statistics that we've found related to the rising cost of healthcare, and then we'll talk about some of the price transparency strategies. So looking at today's cost of healthcare, what we're seeing is premiums continuing to increase in 2017. And this is actually from a new Kaiser Family Foundation study that reported that the average premium in 2017 for single coverage is now over $6,000, and for a family, it's now over $18,000 for average annual premiums, and that is up slightly over 2016. And then we'll look at this from a different perspective, also from the Kaiser Foundation, that tells us that if we could go to that next slide. Thanks. So this is telling us that the deductibles are up 63% from 2011, and then you can see that's a dramatic difference from the increase in workers' earnings, which is at 11%, and inflation at 6%. And then you can also see here the premiums are still far outpacing earnings, almost double, and then they're outpacing inflation by a rate of about 3. So obviously, healthcare costs are a big concern for the average consumer, the average patient today. And so we really want to talk about how can we better engage with our patients to make them more educated about the cost of their financial care, which in turn should help them take care of that payment up front. And so today, we're actually going to go ahead and get started with our first poll question before I introduce our speakers. And that question is, by which methods is your hospital providing patient estimates today? So I'm going to go ahead and launch this poll. And if you could all respond with what you are offering today at your organization in regards to patient estimates. So again, that question is, by which methods is your hospital providing patient estimates today? And the options are at point of service, online, by regular mail, or only upon request. And you can select multiple options for this question. And we'll give everyone about 30 seconds here to vote. So it looks like most organizations on the call today are offering estimates at point of service about 69%. About 50% are offering them only upon request. 25% are offering them online, and then 25% are offering them by regular mail. So we'll close that poll and get back to the presentation. And with that, I'd like to introduce our featured speakers today. Terry McManus is the AVP of our Estimator Pro Services, and Terry has over 25 years of experience in business and technical analysis, and she specializes in product management and software implementations at hospitals across the country. Our other speaker today, who is also on our Estimator Pro team, is Brian Gomes. He's a senior account manager here at PMMC, and he also works closely with our clients with implementations and then daily support related to their workflow processes. And I'm going to, at this point, turn it over to Terry McManus.
Thank you, Brad, and good afternoon, everyone. We're going to talk a little bit about some of the different price transparency strategies that are available today. Most patients find it difficult to locate timely, accurate, and complete health data, but this is exactly what they need to make their decisions. Healthcare providers are working to determine how to respond to federal requirements, and different pricing transparencies are appearing throughout the industry to give patients the information transparencies that they need. Strategies include posting the Charge Master online. This appears to be the most direct route to compliance, but it can be difficult for a patient to navigate, and the price listed on the CBM does not include the insurer's contractual discounts. Another option is posting medium gross charges or posting selected charges online, could provide patients with a better idea of their financial responsibility, but with other factors affecting patient costs, these strategies still might be providing incomplete information. Other options include hotline or online request forms. These require staff follow-up, and there may be inefficiencies when responding back to the patient if sufficient information wasn't provided. Each option on these two screens have pros and cons, and implementing a single price strategy, transparency strategy, may not be enough. What I'm going to talk to today a little bit about is the online patient estimator option and going through what are the requirements for implementing a tool like this. How are the estimates generated? What and who is involved with maintaining a patient estimator tool? And what are the considerations for financial education and planning to the patient? We'll start with the first one, which is implementing the tool. And we work very closely with Metro Health, partnered with us in 2016 to implement an online patient estimator solution. The goal was to provide their patients with a tool that was easy to access, navigate, and understand, and to have a process in place for patient education. For the initial launch, they identified a predetermined list of diagnoses and procedures based on volume metrics and included the top combination of hospital and physician payer contracts. And putting the plan in action, we used the contracts that link to Metro Health's claim history to provide references for all charge types for both the professional and the hospital side. To generate an estimate from the Metro Health website, patients can access the My Cost Estimator in two clicks. It's really important that the link to access the tool should be easy to find and easy to access for the patient to locate on their website. They've also had to compromise a couple other tools. They have their pay your bill online, sign into your account. So it's really a patient-centric area for their patients to access information on their website. When they're generating investments, the patients are first presented when they launch the URL to enter some required contact information, including demographic, first name, last name, to begin the patient estimation process, patients enter required demographic information, including if they are a new or returning patient. Patient education information about what is the primary insurance coverage, what are the copay, what is deductible, who should I contact, that's been included in the, under the frequently asked questions button, so that patients who sometimes can be challenged with medical jargon have an easy access to information about what do those definitions mean. Okay. Next, the patient selects the service category from the drop-down option, or they can simply hover over the body part image on the screen and make a selection from a list of predefined inpatient and outpatient services. We work very closely with Metro in designing their vision of what they want to present to their patients. They wanted it to be user-friendly to all the patients, and if they really weren't sure like where their service category was, they could simply click on a body part like the head or the neck, and they could get a list of predefined options for things to quote. Okay. The service categories are all customizable, and they include those defined services available for quoting. For example, a service category of radiology would include CTs, MRIs, and X-rays. Abdominal and gastrointestinal service would include colonoscopy, laparoscopic colonoscopy, shockwave, lithotripsy. So they're all predefined by the facility, and they can present any combination of available services that they deem important to their patients. The next step is the patient selects their insured from the coverage type drop-down and are prompted to enter the copay and coinsurance information. There are options to provide additional information about their deductible and whether the professional benefits differ from their hospital benefits. Okay. Patients are next presented with the estimate disclaimer language and have to accept the disclaimer language to proceed. It's important to note to have input from both marketing and legal departments to ensure the disclaimer language meets hospital messaging and compliance standards. And it should be really easy to read, bulleted, and really friendly to look at for the patient. Okay. The patient is then presented with a clear, concise estimate summary of their anticipated financial obligation based on the best information known at that time. The estimate summary is inclusive of the disclaimer language, and it can be previewed and printed. If the patient would like a more formalized estimate, they're given the option to provide contact information. This information is automatically queued up in the best practice integrated workflow model, so that the patient access representative can contact the patient in an efficient and timely manner.
Great. Thank you so much, Terry. And at this time, we're going to go ahead and launch our second poll question here, which I'll pull up. And we're going to talk a little bit about the accuracy of estimates. So our question here is, how confident are you in the accuracy of your current estimate process? And here we're asking you to rate your process either by extremely confident, which would be a 90% plus accuracy rate, somewhat confident, which would be between 60 and 90% accuracy, not very confident, 30 to 60%, and then not at all confident, which would be a less than 30% accuracy rate. And we'll give everybody a few seconds here to vote on this poll question. All right, well, the results are in here, and it's overwhelmingly in the somewhat confident category. About 73% answered somewhat confident, 20% answered not very confident, 7% said not at all confident, and 0%, nobody answered extremely confident. So I'm going to go ahead and close that poll question and let Terry continue on here.
Thank you, Brad. Well, data accuracy has a big impact on patient engagement as well as satisfaction. The historical claim data and payer contract rates and terms residing in a contract management system is utilized to determine charges and generate expected reimbursement. The online patient estimation tool uses this data and a sophisticated algorithm to identify historically relevant billing patterns for services available for quoting in the tool. This information is continually monitored and updated by working closely with the hospital-appointed liaison. For Metro Health, the online patient estimate tool went from 14 payer physician combination contracts to 24 that are now available for quoting in the system. In addition to user-friendly portals, point-of-care tools can help provide better educate their patients about cost and quality options. This gives patients a greater voice in their care plan design. Financial coordination staff should continually educate patients about add-on and non-covered service. The goal really is to engage the patient with financial education and planning so we can set expectations for their financial upfront responsibility. From here, I'm going to turn it over to Brian Gomes, who will be presenting the patient financial communication strategy.
Thank you, Terry. So we're going to take a look at some facility-specific goals, point-of-service collection opportunities, and pre-point-of-service collection best practices. Facility-specific goals. One question we like to ask our clients is, where have you struggled previously creating estimates and collections? And to go with that, if you're using an estimator tool, what are your creation goals? Have you established any? And also, what are your collection goals? Do you have an annual collection amount? So as far as estimates go, you should establish a goal for your overall estimate creation percentages of total registrations. So what percentage of those registrations should you expect to receive an estimate for? So for example, out of 100, let's say 1,500 registrations, how many of those should an estimate be created? Percentage targets by patient type. So we do see a much higher volume with outpatient estimates, but we do have several clients that target inpatient and ER and have been very successful in increasing their collections. So have a target by target goal by patient type. The last part here is time frame for estimate creation. Do you anticipate these estimates created prior to the time of service, at the time of service, or do you have a process where you present an estimate at bedside before the patient is discharged? And depending on the patient type, you may have some variation with that time frame and your process. The next part here is collection goals. Do you have a pre-service collection goal or an annual collection goal? And then establishing a collection goal as a percentage of overall patient responsibility. So of all the estimates you created, what percentage of the total balance due would you like to collect? Okay. Pre-service collection goal as a percentage of missed opportunity. So this is an important part where do you expect estimates to be created? So the missed opportunity percentage is based on the number of registrations where you determine an estimate to be created and how many were actually created. And the collection goals time frame. So just like estimate creations, there's a time frame for collection. So at your facility, what actually constitutes for a pre-service collection? Is it within 5 days a day of service, 10 days of service, or is it up to the time of service? So these are some of the things you should take a look at when establishing a process. Having an estimate creation goal and a collection goal is very important if you want to be successful in implementing an estimator tool. Okay, estimate creation criteria. These are some of the items we're going to look at as far as determining when an estimate should be created. So which department? You'll have the opportunity with your front-end staff or your patient access. So that's going to be your pre-service, your pre-registration, benefit verification, and registration groups that you want to target. Patient types. So So you have your inpatient and outpatient ER, but you can also drill down and focus on those patient subtypes of locations like radiology, lab, surgery, GI. So it really plays into your missed opportunity tracking. So you want to make sure that you outlined your services that you want to target, and also the ones that you're not expecting an estimate to be created for. So this makes it much easier to report trends and opportunities for collecting. Estimate creation when patients are scheduled, pre-registered, pre-admitted, point of service. It really depends on your facility and your process, but if you're tying this to collections, you'll be more successful if estimates are created pre-arrival. But again, you want to identify the best opportunity and the right fit for your organization. Okay. So what procedures? You want to start off with your high-dollar procedures. Those are going to be your radiology and surgery services, but they may also be services that you want to avoid just because they're not worth creating estimates for. Those are going to be procedures likely covered by payers. And the last item we have here is insured and uninsured. So with the high deductible plans now, you want to target your insured patient volume, but you also want to make sure that you're presenting estimates to your self-pay population. You want to make sure that you have an estimator tool that can accommodate your self-pay plan. And also, are there payers that you want to exclude? So you may want to try to avoid Medicaid. There's little or no responsibility there, or even dual payers. So if a patient has a secondary insurance, those are, you can avoid creating estimates for those. Okay. And we're going to stop right there for a poll question, Brad.
Yeah, thanks, Brian. So our final poll question of the session is based on how much you're collecting around financial responsibility for patients. So how much does your hospital collect on average when providing an estimate of financial responsibility? And the answers or options here are either less than $100, $100 to $300, $300 to $500, more than $500, or you do not know. And we'll give everyone just a few more seconds here to get their votes in. Okay, the results for this one, 50% do not know, 21% answered between $300 and $500, 14% answered more than $500, and 14% answered $100 to $300. And I'll turn it back to Brian.
All right, thank you, Brad. So let's take a look at a patient collection scenario. Okay, most hospitals have eligibility and a point of service collection process in place. In most cases, as we're showing here, hospitals would check and collect that $50 copayment. But if you see in this example, the missed opportunity is understanding the patient's coinsurance is often the largest portion, over $300 here with that 20% coinsurance. The coinsurance itself is also the least understood and discussed item with the upfront patient education and collections. Various industry studies consistently show if you let the patient know how much they're going to owe in a clear, concise manner, the majority will have the ability and willingness to pay. The notice stats here highlights this point, with 9 out of 10 or 90% of patients are willing and are capable of paying their financial responsibilities up to $500 per year. And nearly 75% are capable and willing to pay up to $1,000 in healthcare expenses. Okay. PMMC's client experience supports these findings. Client's average collection when an estimate was presented was $332, with an average copayment of being around $30. The additional collection benefit value of having and utilizing an accurate estimate system is that additional $302 per patient. This collection rate is, this is a high collection rate, and it's due to presenting the total anticipated patient responsibility versus just presenting or asking for that copay based on the eligibility system. Having a higher user confidence in the estimate accuracy, users are more willing to present and collect on the anticipated amount. And then also clearly, the clarity of the estimate form leads to higher understanding by the patient, who in turn is more willingness to pay. So the bottom line here is that accuracy of the estimate drives the confidence and end results. Okay. Patient estimate workflow scenarios. So when we do implementations, there's really four different areas that we look at: pre-registration and pre-event. So this is where you're going to have your bulk of your estimates are created or should be created. Registration. This is where a lot of times the estimate's going to be already been created in advance. Okay. The time of service registration. These are going to be your walk-ins where your administration staff should be trained to identify the services the patient is coming in for and should be able to quickly create an estimate based on the information provided by that patient. And the last one here is informational requests. So this is going to go back to the pricing transparency. Self-pay and uninsured patients will call ahead because they want to know what their responsibility is. And you're also going to get this from price shoppers trying to get pricing information and also see what financial programs they qualify for. Okay. Estimate creation process. Okay. Are estimates currently being signed, scanned, and included in your patient's record or financial records? We believe it's important that patients sign the estimate form. Studies have found that patients sign financial documents, they feel more responsible for those terms. By requiring a patient to sign those estimates, you have a better chance to make a collection. And with those estimates, your best practice should be scanning the document once you retain that signature. Is there consistency across departments with the estimate creation process? You want to have consistency. The groups that we see the most success have great communication throughout all departments. You don't want a patient coming in for one procedure and getting a quote and being asked for a payment of their responsibility and then coming back for a completely different procedure and not receiving an estimate, or more importantly, not being asked for a collection. So you want to be consistent. Return patients will know what to expect if it becomes part of your organization's protocol. The last part here, registrars and financial counselors need to be confident in the collection process. Your staff will be presenting estimates should be confident in that process. And confidence is going to be carried over by the accuracy of those estimates. You want to make sure that your estimated tool is calculating that patient responsibility correctly. You also want to make sure your staff is trained in reading eligibility returns, and this is very important because, as you know, of course, the eligibility plays a huge part in the estimate calculation. Also, when it comes to collecting, you want your staff to be well-versed in that collection process. So this may be done by having some collection scripting training. So this continues with our collection best practices. Okay. Do patients have a prior balance? If so, it's the perfect time to incorporate that prior balance due communicating on the presented estimate. The estimator tool that you're using should have the capability to track that prior balance due on the estimate. So you're not only addressing what's due today, but you're also trying to collect on any outstanding amounts. The financial counseling functionality, you want to make sure that you have some sort of payment arrangement that would be available to patients just in case they're not able to pay that full amount today. And also have an estimator tool that will allow you to communicate those terms on the estimate form. Address problem areas in departments. There are areas that are challenging to quote. For example, ER is an area that is very difficult to create an estimate, but we have many clients that have had quite a bit of success quoting in ER by just trying to collect the copay or creating an estimate based on the ER visit levels. The same goes for physical therapy. You have your evaluation and reevaluation CPT codes that you can present on an estimate. By targeting just those procedure codes, you're at least presenting the patient with a general quote, if nothing else. The next thing we want to touch on is internal communications. A couple questions we have as it relates to internal communications. What parties and departments should be involved? And who has been involved in prior discussions? So you may want to go back through your notes and communications of past projects and verify who you had discussions with and who you may not have. Try to identify those gaps. Maybe even look back at past experiences and review areas where you didn't have much success. Our suggestion is to start off with the highest level, just your board of directors, making sure everyone is behind your project and everyone is aware of what's going on from the nurses to the physicians. You want to make sure everyone understands that your front-end staff will be creating estimates and trying to make that collection. And they also have to understand that communicating the estimate may cause a delay, but with your new process, your collections are higher and your patients are being informed of their financial responsibilities. Okay. Patient communication. What communication exists today? What communication has been proposed for the future? A few of our suggestions, signage. Do you have signage notifying patients that they're looking for a payment for services rendered today? For example, copays are expected at a time of service, or maybe the patient responsibility will be collected. Patient pamphlets is another area where you could put this information in. You could have public service announcements that you can share with your local news or on your website. Appointment communications and reminders is another way that you can communicate the patient that they need to bring some form of payment when they come in. Are conversations being held at the time of scheduling and pre-registration regarding payment expectations? So this is important too. When your schedulers, they should be well-versed in scripting your estimation and collection process. So it's constantly communicated so the patient understands what they owe and is prepared to pay for their services. Our recommendation is that a patient is contacted within 2 to 5 days in advance of their visit. So if the patient, and also if a patient expresses financial difficulty or any concern about making that payment, that you refer them to a financial counselor where all payment options and programs can be discussed. You want to make sure that you're utilizing all of your resources. So you heard me reference the missed opportunity report throughout the presentation. This is one of the reports that we highly recommend you using. It's helpful to have a high-level report that shows you your volume, the number of accounts that you would expect to receive an estimate, and then the number of estimates actually created. So this is going to allow you to look at those three areas and determine your levels of success. The information can be tracked by date of service, creation date, and this is a report that you should be looking at daily, weekly, and monthly to identify any trends. You also want to utilize a daily detail report to check behind the registration staff for consistency. So at a high level missed opportunity, you're going to have a detail that's more of a drill down on the patient accounts. This is going to allow you to identify any training opportunities for your staff. A good example would be if someone registers 50 patients, but they have only created one estimate. So this would identify a retraining opportunity for that particular employee. Okay. So as far as increasing collection and fostering competition, let your team join in on the success. It never hurts to offer a bonus gift card or just recognition to a particular staff member that has exceeded collection expectations. As a group, maybe you want to offer a pizza party for your team. Once you met your collection goals, maybe it's for the month or the quarter. These are all great ways that we've seen work for clients in improving their collection percentages. So this is one of our scripting templates that we incorporate within our application, and it's also presented in our implementation training. This is what you want to go through with your registration staff. So it's a very PC approach to addressing collecting your patient's responsibility. You want to make sure your staff is polite and to the point. The scripting document like this prepares your staff for the type of responses they may receive when communicating that patient financial responsibility. Okay, so takeaways, generate and provide estimates for all applicable encounters. So it's important that you look to provide estimates to all your applicable encounters to maximize your collections. Remember to utilize collection resources in the estimation system and elsewhere. You want to make sure your staff is comfortable creating estimates and comfortable communicating that balance due. Be aware of your estimate and collection efforts are being monitored. So reports here, monitoring your facility and your staff performance. Having a missed opportunity report that you're reviewing daily is a very important for your success. And the theme throughout the presentation is providing accurate estimates either at the point of service or online keeps your community informed, increases patient satisfaction scores, and facilitates timely pre-service and point of service collections. Okay. I'll turn it over to Brian.
Thank you very much, Brian. At this time, we are going to take questions from the audience. So if you do have any questions for Terry or Brian, please go ahead and enter them in the chat feature of your GoToWebinar tab, and I will forward them over to our speakers today. We did have one question during the session of whether the slides will be available, and yes, they will. We will send out a copy of the slides as well as a recording of the session shortly after today's webinar. So one question I have for Terry and Brian that just came through was around the online patient tool. How long does it typically take to implement something like the online patient estimator tool that we saw?
Hi Brad, this is Terry, I'll take that one. It takes approximately 90 days for us to gather up the historical billing data, the payer contractual rates and terms, and to kind of run that data through the process of creating the expected reimbursements for the estimator tool that you guys may want to present.
Okay, great. Another question we have here is related to the automated workflow system. Brian, can you speak to some of the benefits that are associated with having that automated workflow?
Yeah, sure, Brad. At PMC, we really like to refer to the work queues as driving your pre-service collections and really incorporating your workflow into the application. And that's really going to avoid like emails, communication that you currently have. One good example of a workflow that we do have integrated in this system or we can do is having, let's say you have your benefit verification team, they're verifying benefits, they're going to create the estimate. At that point, they're going to save it with a status, and it's going to go to a financial counselor or to another group that's responsible for notifying the patient. So that way that you know your estimates are being created, and not only being created, that responsibility is actually being communicated back to the patient.
Okay, great. And one other question we have here, what is the expected turnaround time for when a patient makes a request in the online estimate tool?
Well, if they just stay within the tool, they get their estimated responsibility automatically because it pops up right there for them. If they want a more formalized estimate, they can go ahead and click on get additional information, and that gets queued up in the automatic workflow within the tool, and then the patient access person will get back to them, typically that same day or early the next day.
Okay, great. Thank you, Terry. And unless we have any other further questions, we'll go ahead and wrap up today's session. I'd like to thank everyone for attending today's session, Creating a Patient-Centric Experience to Increase Transparency in Collections. And I'd also like to thank our featured speakers today, Terry McManus and Brian Gomes. And if anybody has any specific questions after the call, their contact information is on the slides here, and I'm sure they would be happy to take any questions that you have. Terry and Brian, any closing thoughts for us?
No, I have nothing. Thank you, Brad.
Yeah, no, thank you very much for organizing everything.
All right, great. Well, I hope everyone has a great rest of the day and rest of the week. And we will be sending out a copy of the slides and a recording here shortly. Thanks again.
Thank you.